Hello everyone, my name is Nirma and I am part of AWS's Solutions Architect team. I'm super excited to be with all of you here today. Today I'm going to walk you through a framework for cloud financial management and will describe how organizations with good cloud financial governance are able to unlock and accelerate the economic value promised by cloud. On today's agenda, we have an introduction to how cloud has turned technology procurement and consumption on its head, and how that 180-degree motion necessitates a new model for financial governance that many organizations are already evolving into. Once we all are on the same page with how cloud has changed things, we will dive a little deeper into the cloud financial management and how its related activities and capabilities drive business outcomes, ranging from decision-making using real-time data to increasing the predictability of your cloud spend to building a self-sustaining, cost-aware organization, and even driving revenue and profitability growth. At the end, we will finish today's session with a quick overview of how AWS can help your organization's cloud journey. Make it a successful one, regardless of whether you are contemplating your first workload or looking to drive deeper unit cost improvements to your existing cloud workloads. So, where do we start? I'm going to skip the all about AWS piece because I hope we all have a baseline level of understanding of what cloud is and what cloud offers our respective businesses in terms of potential for disruption and transformation. However, what I do want to share is that when we look at companies and businesses that use AWS, we often hear and in fact see cost savings to be a primary driver for the decision to use cloud. But organizations that use AWS, they realize value above and beyond just TCO reduction. Organizations also realize value in staff productivity, which includes improvements to their staff efficiency, improvement in operational resilience, which refers to improvements in quality of service that they deliver and respective SLAs. It also improves business agility, which includes increased innovation and reduction in go-to-market time for new features and products that the organizations are building. And while we hear customers realizing these areas of values, very often we ourselves set out to quantify this on our own last year. Through a US-based customer study, the study found that on average, customers using AWS were able to reduce their IT spend by 27.4%. They were able to increase virtual machines managed per admin by 57.9%, and they were able to reduce unplanned downtime by 56.7%. They also decreased the time to market for their new features by 37.1%. The study also found that these numbers actually improved for companies that had been using AWS for a longer period of time or who are using more AWS services. So instead of asking yourself whether cloud is right for you, I think a more important question is to ask yourself what value you expect to realize across these four value areas as you plan your next digital transformation. Now that I have spoken about digital transformation, today's business leaders, as most of you are there in the audience, business leaders race to move quicker, innovate more, and remain competitive. While this Transformation is often marked by technological advancements. It affects ripple across organizations and processes that impact both what we do and how and why we do it. From a finance and procurement organization perspective, the process for capital budgeting, capital request, approvals, procurement, and installing physical infrastructure is one that has been learned and made a standard practice over decades. For example, engineering or IT teams are typically the requester of the resources. Finance teams act as approvers and procurers. Operations team, they rack, stack, and hand off ready-to-use infrastructure to the teams who request it. This process, despite being well-established and one that provides predictability from a capital budgeting and forecasting perspective, is one that happens across organizational silos. It involves procurement cycles that can last days, weeks, or even months, until entire infrastructure is burned in and ready to be consumed by the requester teams. However, during these procurement cycle times, which are usually long, business conditions can change. And sometimes abruptly, the finance teams will find themselves in a risky position, having to manage long-term capital investments that may no longer be the right type of investment, or even worse, no longer required. Approvals, procurement cycles, and operationalizational activities also slow the pace of experimentation and innovation that is needed today for technology teams who become blocked based on the dependencies that they have no control over. This process, as well established as it is an antiquated model. And as we will see in the next slide, it requires adjustments in order to be successful in the cloud. With the adoption of cloud, infrastructure procurement and consumption is no longer dependent on a chain of dependencies. In the cloud model, technology and product teams are no longer just builders, but operators. They are now become owners of their products, responsible for most of the activities that were historically associated with finance and operations teams, including procurement and deployment. All it really takes to provision a cloud resource is a user account and right set of permissions. This is also what reduces IT and finance risk. And by that, what I mean is teams are always just a few clicks away or a few API calls away from terminating idle or unnecessary cloud resources. This is also what allows technology teams to innovate faster, the agility and ability to spin up and then tear down experiments. And while the variable nature of cloud consumption may impact predictability from a capital budgeting and forecasting perspective, cloud provides organizations with the ability to reduce the cost of over-provisioning, as well as reduce the opportunity cost associated with conservative under-provisioning. Now, all of this is a big transformation for organizations that are used to working in the old model. It's incumbent on us to think about the best way our customers can undergo this transformation successfully. The mental model that can help with this transition is think of cloud as just another data center, but one that requires us to evolve our existing financial governance capabilities. As we mentioned earlier, AWS offers on-demand provisioning that makes it easy for anyone to spin up resources. What kind of guardrails are needed to ensure only those individuals or teams that need to spin up resources for the right reasons are able to do so? AWS offers 175 plus services. each with different resource types and different pricing models, from on-demand to commitment-based purchase options like savings plan and reserved instances, as well as EC2 spot instances. While AWS's pricing model is transparent, navigating this pricing landscape can be slightly complex even for advanced end users. Over-provisioned cloud infrastructure, especially production environments, are challenging to resize. Studies have indicated that customers who migrate to AWS often bring their over-provisioned on-premises infrastructure with them. And those that are born in cloud, they don't have right mechanisms in place to resize workloads. As already discussed, forecasting cost is made more complex given the elastic usage patterns that are associated with dynamic workloads and pricing models that optimize on behalf of customers. Will it still be possible to use pre-existing annual budget and forecasting processes to set expectations with your business regarding your cloud spend? When resources are provisioned, their owners often have little to no visibility into what their applications are costing in the cloud. Technology organizations are historically not attuned to costs, unlike other first-order non-functional requirements, such as functional correctness, performance, security, scalability. Finally, even after cloud waste is identified and addressed, the dynamic nature of cloud consumption means that there is a chance waste may still occur. So with this said, can we quantify how using cloud as a traditional data center manifests it in terms of the economic and value creation, which is the promise of a cloud? So not surprisingly, the old model has unintended consequences. So the study on the left side that you see, in this conducted study, this particular survey, they found that 80% of respondents acknowledged poor financial management related to cloud. These same respondents also acknowledged that poor financial management had a negative impact on their businesses, including deceleration of cloud adoption, slower innovation, decreased quality of service, underutilized resources, and increased costs. Study on the right-hand side, which was surveyed by Flexera, that talks about a cross-section of cloud computing. Most respondents were cloud decision makers and users from organizations. The size were 100 to 10,000 employees in these organizations. In this survey, they found that cloud cost management issues are the top challenges regardless of cloud maturity. They also found that number one priority in 2020 was cloud cost optimization. And in fact, it was the top cloud initiative for the fifth year running. They also noted that cloud users self-report 30% wasted spend. However, spend is likely less efficient. So as many organizations tend to underestimate the amount of waste. In working with customers to identify waste, Flexera has found that on average, actual waste is 35% or even higher. With all of this said, ask yourself, where are you in your cloud consumption journey? The new model, the old model, or you are in somewhere in between? In thinking about your organization, do you see how are you currently measuring, monitoring, and creating accountability for your cloud spend? If you are new to AWS or planning on using AWS, do you have a plan to establish cost and usage visibility? What cost optimization levers are you currently using to optimize your spend? If you are yet to start using AWS, are you familiar with common usage-based and pricing model-based optimizations? and planning. How do you currently plan for future cloud usage and spend? Do you have a methodology to quantify value generation for a new migration? Have you evolved your current budgeting and forecasting processes to adopt variable usage of cloud? And finally, what are some of the operational processes and tools that you are currently using to manage your cloud expenditure? And who is leading those efforts? Have you put any thought into how things will work from a day-to-day operational perspective once you start using AWS? And by the way, let's talk about what good looks like. So does good mean we should always be maintaining or reducing our total AWS spend, regardless of our usage? How much should we allow costs to rise in response to increased demand that we see? I love sharing this graph because it demonstrates a few things that help answer these questions. Let's first look at the orange line. As you move to or use AWS, you will be able to implement a number of optimizations to continuously reduce your costs. Levers that include right sizing, to elasticity, to savings plans, to serverless architecture. What's also important about the orange line is that the focus isn't on aggregate or total cloud spend, but rather unit cost. Unit costs are cost per a business metric. This business metric can be related or relevant to your organization. Maybe it can be for you cost per transaction, cost per ride, cost per flight, or cost per widget in your application. So measuring and reporting unit costs provides a more accurate representation of how efficient you are with your cloud usage. The blue bars that you see on this graph represents cloud usage. In this graph, we see an increase in cloud usage that might be a result of increased demand against existing workloads. Maybe the requests to the workloads are high, or expansion through global product offerings, migrations, or additional on-premises workloads or new born-in-cloud product offerings are causing this demand to increase. It's a cool graph because it demonstrates the ability for our cloud efficiency to improve through various optimizations, even in the face of increased cloud usage. Yes, your overall cloud spend may increase, but with a well-architected workload, even with more transactions, more writes, and more widgets, you'll always find a way to improve your cloud cost efficiency. Now that we have a sense of what good looks like, let's dive deeper into the activities and capabilities that will help your organization achieve this target state. So we collectively call this group of activities cloud financial management. Cloud financial management, which going forward I will refer as CFM, enables finance, product, technology, and business organizations to manage, optimize, and plan costs as they grow their usage on AWS. The primary goal of CFM is to enable customers to achieve their business outcomes in the most cost-efficient manner and accelerate economic and business value creation while finding the right balance between agility and control. What we will walk through next is a formal classification of all the activities and capabilities into these four areas that create the building blocks for a framework that establishes a baseline level of cloud cost management. Understanding across our stakeholder groups can be improved with this framework. So we start with measurement and accountability. An area of the framework that focuses on capabilities that enable organizations to establish cost, visibility, and accountability for spend. So these include leveraging accounts and tags to create a representation of how workloads and organizations are mapped to their AWS consumption. Building the right level of granularity for cost reporting and monitoring for stakeholders to enable real-time decision and avoid cloud budget overruns. Allocating cloud costs by implementing showbacks or chargebacks for cloud spend, including spend on commitment-based purchase, options, shared services, and marketplace purchases to drive most cost-aware cloud consumption. And finally, measuring and reporting cloud efficiency and value KPIs, enabling organizations to measure the impact of cost optimizations and validate expected versus actual value creation. Here is a great example of our customer that implemented cost visibility, which enabled more efficient cloud spend for them. So many of you know or have used Lyft. Lyft's business has grown dramatically in recent years. For example, the company's annual rides tripled from 2015 to 2016. And then their annual rides doubled again in 2017. This growth actually led to their increased AWS usage naturally, and thereby increased costs. So Lyft decided to use AWS cost management services, such as the cost and usage report, to create cost visibility for its engineering teams. They also adopted a cost per ride unit metric, which guided their cost optimization efforts. Through a combination of ride sizing optimizations and commitment-based purchase optimization, Lyft was able to reduce their cost per ride by 40%, despite the tripling and then doubling of their demand for their business. Cost optimization is the second area of the framework, and it focuses on capabilities that enable organizations to pay only for the resources they need. So cost optimization includes ensuring architectures, solutions, products, and deployments are designed and operated in the most cost-effective manner from the get-go, from the very beginning, to avoid incurring technical debt. Identifying and recouping spend associated with cloud waste for cloud resources that are already deployed. This happens when we incorrectly size resources or observe usage patterns different than what we expected them to be. We can take those savings and do something more productive with them. Using the best purchasing option to drive down unit cost for our workloads, whether that's savings plans for EC2, Fargate or Lambda, reserved instances for RDS, ElastiCache, and other reservable services, or EC2 spot instances, which offer the deepest cost savings for fault-tolerant EC2 workloads. And finally, reducing TCO of cloud. Whenever AWS innovates on behalf of their customers by adopting new services, regions, features, solutions, or price reductions. On the last point, we have a history of innovating on behalf of our customers. For the finance folks in today's audience, one such innovation you probably already know about is a pricing model that was launched in the late 2019. So we essentially went back to the drawing board and asked ourselves how we can reduce the management overhead associated with reserved instances for our customers. What we came up with was savings plan, a pricing model that offers significant savings on Amazon EC2, AWS Fargate, and AWS Lambda usage. Savings plans requires customers to commit to a consistent amount of usage For example, say $10 per hour as an example for over 1 or 3 years. And in exchange, customers will receive a lower price for that usage. Savings plans offer the significant savings just like reserved instances, but with greater flexibility. For the more technical members in today's audience, another example of how AWS innovates on your behalf is with the launch of Graviton 2 processors for various EC2 instance types, as well as for RDS and ElastiCache services. AWS Graviton 2 powered instances have the highest performance within their instance families, along with 20% lower cost when compared to the other instances with the same vCPU and memory configuration, which leads to up to 40% better price performance versus comparable x86 based instances. This is the best price performance within their instance families and leads to real saving for our customers. Planning and forecasting, the third area of the framework, focuses on capabilities that enable customers to improve business predictability for current and new cloud workloads. These include evolving your current budgeting and forecasting processes to become more agile, more dynamic, and accommodate the more variable nature of cloud consumption. It may even evolve incorporating additional units of forecasting, moving away from trend-based forecasting that leverages unit costs, leveraging new methodologies to estimate the cost of workloads using AWS tools like Migration Evaluator, AWS Pricing Calculator, or just a plain old POC that is deployed to a test account, tagged, applied a load against, and measured. As we have discussed earlier, a large part of the value that customers realize when using cloud goes above and beyond just cost savings. As such, it's important to quantify expected value creation across staff productivity, operational resilience, and business agility. To build a data-driven process when considering future workload migrations, or maybe even benchmarking your value creation for existing cloud workloads. And finally, many customers live in hybrid world because they are in the middle of a digital transformation that is accelerated by cloud. To enable a holistic end-to-end view of your entire IT state, it's important to integrate your cloud planning processes with those that you currently use already for your on-premises IT. As you plan your move to cloud, you may have to build additional business cases on your own, which is a time-consuming process and does not always identify the most cost-effective deployment and purchasing options. So, Migration Evaluator, which was formerly called TSO Logic, quickly provides a business case to make sound AWS planning and migration decisions. With Migration Evaluator, your organization gets access to AWS expertise, visibility into the cost associated with multiple migration strategies, leveraging different types of commitment-based purchase option, right-sizing resources, insights on how reusing existing software licensing reduces cost further. Migration Evaluator is leveraged at the very beginning of a migration journey. We do not require you to have an agent installed on your servers. We don't look at processes running on your servers or query your usernames or review any of your data. So we have a very low bar of entry. With Migration Evaluator, you will receive a summary report and access to the viewer to run additional cost modeling scenarios. The business summary report includes an on-premises estimate and two future state modeling scenarios. note that migration evaluator factors the server provisioning, storage attached to it, power, software licensing for OS into the on-premises cost estimate. However, it does not include employee cost, migration tools, professional services, shared storage, and software outside of OS. Cloud financial operations, our fourth and final area of framework, focuses on capabilities that enable customers to evolve organizations, processes, automation and tools, and establish a self-sustaining, cost-aware culture of innovation. So these include securing executive sponsorship to establish a CFM owner or a team that will standardize programmatic approach to cost management, which can drive real results and quantify cost and value outcomes compared to any isolated or ad hoc requests. Ensuring stakeholders across organizations have a common understanding of cloud cost. This can be done through reporting, education, gamification, celebrating efficiency wins, and establishing new working partnerships between finance and technology teams to enable more accurate budgeting and cloud spend monitoring. Building guardrails that help maintain or increase the agility provided by cloud without having to worry about costly cloud mistakes. For example, unintentionally provisioning the beefiest resource types or accidentally leaving resources running over the holidays. So finally, evolving existing mechanisms, be it processes, automation, or tools, to help proliferate cost efficiency in a continuous manner across your cloud journey. I wanted to share one customer story with you today. This one is about MicroStrategy, an AWS customer that started to observe increased cloud spend as its customers flocked to its AWS-based analytics solution. Increased cloud cost also resulted from internal R&D programs that they were running. They started to leverage AWS for test workloads, and education teams started leveraging AWS to deploy internal and external education services for their customers. MicroStrategy embarked on a top-down cost management initiative with a goal of reducing cloud spend by 20%. As part of this effort, MicroStrategy redesigned their organization and built a hub and spoke model for CFM. The hub, a team of cloud and technology experts, where they were responsible for creating cost and usage visibility and governance. Spokes, on the other hand, or you can call them business units, would plug into this data created by the hub team and governance frameworks and leverage them to consume cloud more efficiently. In this case, MicroStrategy leveraged the AWS cost and usage report and leveraged their own technology, MicroStrategy Analytics, to create cost dashboards and graphs. Through targeted resource governance, which included environment scheduling, two-week resource leases, deployment automation, as well as reserved instances, EC2 spot instances, MicroStrategy was able to reduce its AWS spend by 30% annually. MicroStrategy is a great example of how an organizational model for CFM has helped drive business units to accomplish more while using fewer cloud resources. For example, their technology organization has been able to increase its AWS use to support new benchmarking and testing initiatives, but at a lower overall cost. Their education organization was able to deliver 50% more training environments at a recent MicroStrategy World Conference, but only had to increase their cloud spend by 10%, and they get it done. So, with this, I'll move on to the to recap what we have seen about the framework. So it's not only to create visibility and optimize cloud spend, but to make cloud spend more predictable for the businesses and stakeholders and build a long-term, self-sustaining, cost-aware culture supporting all waypoints in the cloud journey. These activities and capabilities are actually very similar to what you already do for on-premise environments. But instead of performing them in a macro manner, we will need to apply them in a more micro way, continuously, for many of the reasons that we mentioned earlier. This becomes a cyclical process, the velocity and depth of which will typically be based on how far you are on your cloud journey, but also on the level of importance you place on cost efficiency. So we have already discussed about various outcomes for your organization, included a couple of customer stories. But in early 2020, we decided to perform a quantitative study to identify additional business benefits that are sometimes very hard to ascertain in our customer engagements. As such, we commissioned 451 research to survey 500 US-based enterprise decision makers with their experience with cloud financial management. To no one's surprise, the study found that the customers who implement CFM reduced their unit costs, and these cost savings increased for customers who had been using AWS for a longer period of time, increasing it from 51% to 61% for customers using AWS for only 2 years versus 5+ years. What was even more interesting was that customers who had been using AWS longer not only experienced increased profitability, but that profitability was driven by both a mix of cost savings and revenue growth. For example, for customers using AWS for 5 years or more, 78% of them saw their revenue grow, and 71% of them saw their profits increase. Similar trends were observed with business risk. Customers who used AWS longer reduced their business risk more than customers who were very early on in their cloud journey, 69% versus 57%. So why is this? Why is CFM leading to business outcomes above and beyond just cost savings? Well, the study also found that the same customers who realized larger savings, revenue profitability, and reduced business risk were the same customers who had implemented a larger set of CFM practices, were performing CFM more regularly, weekly, sometimes daily, and were also using a larger number of AWS billing and cost management and governance tools. These services and tools, which included AWS Cost Explorer, well-architected tool, AWS Control Tower, Consolidated Billing, and AWS CloudWatch, just to name a few. These services enable customers to implement guardrails for well-behaved cloud consumption, which has a multiplier effect on cost-effective and secure experimentation, which may ultimately lead to increased business agility. As you walk away from this session today, we want to have you a framework for CFM, but we want you to be armed with a playbook that you can use to start small, experiment, iterate, and build upon that as you get started with your own cloud journey. So remember, perfect is the enemy of good. So compare your existing CFM best practices to this list, or use this playbook to kickstart your activities if you are deliberating on where to start. Let's first identify someone or a team that will be ultimately responsible for managing your AWS cost. Having an owner will expedite with planning, execution, coordination, reporting of outcomes of CFM activities. Whether the CFM activities are executed in a centralized cloud business office, cost operations team, or decentralized at the edge manner. Second, finance and technology stakeholders should establish a partnership immediately and create a regular bi-directional communication channel between them. This will allow finance stakeholders to become more cloud savvy, understanding different pricing models, payment options, etc., and technology stakeholders to become more finance savvy, participate in cloud budgeting, cost and usage reporting, building trust, etc. Both of this are required for success. Next, attribute the cost of the cloud back to the lines of business that are responsible for deploying it and using the cloud. Allocate the cost of your account using AWS organizations or the cost of resources using AWS cost allocation tags to drive cost awareness for your technology teams. You can report an baseline cloud spend and unit costs and track them over time to determine the efficiency gains associated with these cloud financial management activities. You can provide all internal stakeholders with access to the AWS Cost Explorer screen that you see and ensure AWS Cost Explorer dashboards and reports are as visible as any other dashboards. For example, same as system monitors and sales dashboards. You can leverage savings plans, reserved instance, and EC2 right sizing recommendations from AWS Cost Explorer screen to start reducing the cost associated with steady state workloads, idle and underutilized resources. You can also leverage AWS budgets and AWS cost anomaly detection to preview, which is now in preview, to improve cost predictability and detect variances. You can detect it much earlier. Last but not the least is identify education offerings from AWS to continuously improve your cloud IQ across your stakeholder base, whether it's the AWS certified cloud practitioner exam, which you can take in the comfort of your home, or any of the resources available to you, which I'll share in the end of this presentation. So we can provide you support for each step of your journey through a number of service offerings, from building business cases that help qualify the benefits of moving to AWS to demonstrations of native cost management tools and services to cost optimization assessments that can help identify actionable cost saving opportunities. We can also support you with hands-on workshop for finance and technology stakeholders, to CFM meetups, to trainings and certification offerings, and introduction to consulting and tooling partners. Please ask your account team for an introduction to the cloud economics team. If you don't have an account team, please contact us using the resource slide. So if you are interested in this, the good news is we are continuously investing in resources that can help you get started. The links that you see, they involve a well-architected cost optimization white paper, which can be found in our AWS console, and a set of hands-on labs that walk you through number of best practices mentioned today. So enroll in our CFM for Builders course, which helps technology stakeholders dive deeper into cost-aware architectures. Keep tabs on AWS cost management blogs and leverage partners that can help accelerate your CFM efforts. For those looking to network and make connections with other CFM practitioners, the FinOps Foundation, which is now a Linux Foundation community, is a great place to establish and grow those peer relationships. We would like to conclude by reminding you that helping our customers save money is part of our DNA. It's who we are as a company, and it's how we prioritize our business, working back from the customer. So with this, thank you for having me today. And I'll check whether we have some questions. Okay, so there is a question. The question is, can we customize dashboards and reports? Yes, of course. There are various filters available on the dashboard, Cost Explorer dashboard, where you can choose a particular region where you have deployed your workload, or you can choose a particular service that you are using. And then you can also filter it by tags, the tags that you are using to identify your resources. And you can then download the report as well in a form of a CSV, and you can use that. So the dashboard is very much customizable, and it can be customized as per your needs.
So thanks everyone for having me today. Look forward to for hearing from you. And with this, I'll end this session.